Thank you for joining with us today as we talk about pressing towards the prize. As we continue our series in Philippians, I hope that you will just dig in, make yourself ready for what God wants to speak to you through this. But before we do that, the worship team is going to lead us in worship. So open up your heart, ready to receive what God has for you today.
Blessed assurance, Jesus. Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. And what He did for me on Calvary is more than enough. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Perfect submission, all is at rest. The author of tomorrow has ordered my steps. So this is my story, this is my song, praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior. He will never fail, no. He will never fail. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. That's why I trust Him, that's why I trust Him. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. That's why I trust Him, that's why I trust Him. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. That's why I trust Him, that's why I trust in God, my Savior. Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. That's why I trust Him, that's why I trust Him.
Thank you, worship team. Today, as we look in Philippians again, if you have your Bible, you can turn to Philippians 3, and we're going to be talking about pressing on towards the prize. Now, are we going somewhere? And it's good to keep our eyes on the destination so that we stay in track. In fact, Yogi Berra said this, and I think it's a great saying. You got to be careful if you don't know where you're going, because you might not get there. Another one of my great philosophers that I like to look at is Charlie Brown. It says, aim at nothing and you'll surely hit it. You know, as we have to have a goal in mind for our walk with the Lord. In Philippians 3:14, it says, I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us. The idea of pressing on reflects the intensity of an athlete running a desperate race to the finish line, eager to win first prize. Swindoll said that, and I think it's important that we look at that. We have to be intense about what we're doing, about where we're reaching out to. But there are two obstacles that he points to in Philippians. And there are obstacles to the prize. And the first is the influence of others. In Philippians 3:2-3, it says, watch out for those dogs, those evildoers, those manipulators of the flesh. For if we who are circumcised, who serve God by His Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. Paul warns the Philippians about some who would seek to interject their own beliefs into Christianity. This was particularly interesting because of the Jewish influence. He had strong language for them. He reminds the Philippians that the Judaizers often is far less than what they are now. He reminds the Philippians that what the Judaizers are doing, and they're trying to interject their own thing. Now, probably nobody in the past, couple years has even thought about pressuring you to be circumcised so that your faith is stronger. But we are pressured in other ways. We are pressured to feel that we need to abandon certain things or follow certain things that the world thinks makes us closer to Christianity. We may feel they may want us to abandon things that we're doing, but we worship the Spirit and the glory of Christ, and we put no confidence in our flesh. You know, we get pressured by people to do things that we shouldn't do. And I just encourage you to stand firm. If it doesn't line up with the Word, it doesn't line up. The second thing is the accomplishments of the past. In Philippians 3:4-6, it says, though I myself have reasons to have such confidence, if someone else thinks that they have reason to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal, persecuting the church, as for righteousness based in the law, faultless. Paul had great accomplishments for the Lord in his life. In fact, Craddock says, were he so minded, he could preach the Judaizer's sermon better than they could. And it's easy to point to our past and what we've done and just be satisfied with that. But there's nothing in Paul's life that suggests that he was ready to retire Christianity, that he was done. I said, I'm done. I'm finished. I've done everything I can do. No, none of us are done. There is no retirement date until you see Jesus. And see, we need to be working. We need to be touching people's lives. Grandparents, you need to be continuing to pray and seek for God to do things in your kids' lives, in your grandkids' lives, in your great-grandkids' lives. We need to be praying and seeking God to do those things. We cannot be satisfied, well, I got saved and I'm done. Or I've taught my Sunday school class and I'm finished. No, we are never done with serving the Lord and giving what we have. See, even from prison, Paul continues to reach out. We can't let the influence of others or our past accomplishments keep us from pressing on towards the prize. So what is the path for the prize? First of all, to know Jesus. In Philippians 3, 7 and 8, but whatever were gains to me, now consider for the sake of the Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus as my Lord and Savior. For whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ. What were Paul's losses? When he became a Christian, he lost his reputation, his mission, his family, his people, his life. When we embrace Jesus that way, everything changes. All his losses were worth losing in order to know Christ. Christ as Lord was so valuable, he considered it the pinnacle of his life. He considers everything else rubbish. The CEB version says sewer trash. Swindoll says this. The term literally means dung, excrement, manure. This is the strongest possible word he could use to describe, this is what I consider all my gains from the past. Worthless. McGrath says, the Christ who knows us so well longs for us to know him in turn. McGrath goes on to say that we know Christ in our minds, in our imagination, in our hearts, in our memories. In our minds, we study the Scripture. And we place ourselves in the stories that we're going through, that we're reading, that we see how God works even in our life. If you put yourself in there, and it affects our mind and our hearts, allowing us to feel and experience the things that were there, the forgiveness, the touch of Christ. Memories, remembering what Christ has done for us, allowing us to spur our hopes and what he's promised to do. Sometimes even sharing our memories, what God does, it opens up other people that they can feel and experience God. It says that we need to share the word of our testimony and how God has brought us through things. It helps other people to go through things. Philippians 3:8 in the New Living Translation says this, yes, everything else is worthless when compared to the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage, so that I could gain Christ. We need that. We need to know Jesus that way. We also need, the second thing is trust Jesus. Philippians 3, 9 through 11, it says, and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ. The righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ. Yes, I want to know the power of his resurrection and to participate in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining the resurrection from the dead. Righteousness, in its most simplistic form, is to be counted and right in the sight of God. You know, that's pretty amazing, to be counted and right in the sight of God. Sin leaves us separated from God. Grasping for meaning, direction, hope, forgiveness, all those things. In Christ, we have those things. And this matters as we're pressing towards the prize. Our eyes are on the future destination and our future lives. This world is just a temporary thing. It's eternity that we should look at. Righteousness can only be given to us considering our faith. It's the power of his resurrection. That's what has completed everything. It's the power to endure suffering like he did. And I sure hope that the resurrection, when life is over, is part of what I am. And I know that. And Romans 6, 3 through 5, it says this, "Oh, do you not know that all who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We are therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may have new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in the resurrection like his." Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that you are going to let me participate in the resurrection, that I have life because of what you've done. You know, we got to trust him. And it's tough sometimes, but you can trust the Lord. The third thing we need to do is run to Jesus. Philippians 3, 12 through 14 says this, "Not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of what Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which Christ God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." Paul admits he has some growing to do. He isn't perfect yet. His race isn't over. And I'm glad to hear him admit it, because I can admit it too. I'm not perfect. My race isn't over. But Paul has three strategic things for winning the race. And these strategies are this. First, forget what is behind. We can't live in the past. We apologize for our mistakes, make amends if possible, and receive forgiveness from God. Life can only be understood backwards. It must be lived forward. You can't go back and look at the past all the time. You got to move forward. Strain forward for what lies ahead. The athlete throws himself forward in the race with all his energy, strained to the very uttermost. Swindoll said that. What in our life demonstrates that we're straining towards growth in God? What are the things that we're doing? Does it mean that straining, it takes some work to get there? You know, it takes work to go get up a little bit earlier to read your Bible. It takes time to pray, to set aside. It takes time to be open to him. You got to be straining. It takes a little work to get there. So we forget what lies behind, we strain for what lies ahead, and we never give up. Philippians 3, 15 and 16. "Of all of us, then, who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make it clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already obtained." Hang on to where you are. Start moving forward. From prison, Paul encourages the Philippians not to give up. Here Paul is in jail, encouraging the Philippians not to give up. Faith for Paul involved running, wrestling, striving, fighting, none of which would end until Christ's return. We can't give up until Christ's return. 2 Timothy 4:7, "I fought the good fight. I finished the race. I've kept the faith." That's the thing that we need to do. Keep fighting. Finish the race. And keep the faith. You know, our lives are going someplace. And it's good to keep things on our and our eyes and our destination. We need to be focused on where we're going. The New Living Translation of Philippians 3:14 says, "I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God through Christ Jesus is calling us. So my question is, how are you doing in the race? You may have failed. You may have made mistakes. Make things right. Are you watching from the stands? I just want to see what everybody else is doing. No, get in the race. If you realize you're not in the race, get in the race. Are you ready to start? Well, maybe I just got to work out a few more things, and then I'll get in the race. No, get in the race. Get ready to start. Maybe you're running a bit ragged or fatigued, or you're thinking about quitting. Straining, pressing towards. Keep working. I'm reminded of a time I went hiking with my two boys, and I didn't realize that the trail I went was way more than I was expecting. And I thought, well, this would be a good one to go on. So I get walking. I'm like, man, when are we going to get to the top? When are we going to get to the top? And the thought that the Lord just kept putting in my heart was, just make three more steps. Just make three more steps. Just make three more steps. And I kept doing that, and I kept going, and I finally got there. And that was, then I realized it was a four on the difficulty scale. If five was the most difficult, it was a four. I was like, next time I'm going to check it. But I got through it. And I had my boys with me, and they kept encouraging me. They kept helping me. And that's the way we need to be in our faith. We may be feeling fatigued or ragged and think about quitting, but yet press on, strain. You'll get through it. Running with endurance. Just keep on focusing and get there. See, the path of the prize is to know Jesus, to trust Jesus, and to run to Jesus. You can get there. Let me encourage you today. You can get there. Keep moving forward. Aim at the things you want to hit, and you'll get there. Lord, I just thank you for each and every person. Lord, I thank you for the encouraging word to press on towards the prize, to focus, to get to where we need to be at. Lord, thank you that you help us get there. Lord, you're our God. You know what we need, when we need it, and I thank you for opening doors for us. Lord, I thank you for letting us move forward in our relationship with you. Lord, thank you for all you do for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I'm so glad you're joining with us today. If you go to our website, there are ways to give. We'd love for you to be a part here, and I encourage you to come and join us Sundays at 10 a.m. We'd love for you to be here. May God bless you. May you find peace and strength every day.